worship outside for the foreseeable future until it gets too cold and we need to come indoors. At that point, we'll probably have multiple services. And so logistically, it's not going to work very well at this point to have Sunday school classes during that time. For the fall semester, we're not going to have Sunday school for children. However, we do want to provide some opportunities for parents to do in-home discipleship for their family. So please plan on attending a meeting, short meeting right after church on September 13th. I'll get more details about that then. This morning, we're going to hear Grant again preach from the Ten Commandments. And as I thought about a call to worship, I thought of Psalm 119, where David praises the law of the Lord. Psalm 119, verse 1, says this: "Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with their whole heart." The reality is, the past few weeks, the Ten Commandments have sort of beat us up spiritually. They reveal our sin. And yet, the law is good. We've seen the truthfulness of the law, the righteousness of the law. In Psalm 119, David, who himself got beat up by God's law, was still able to say, "Lord, your law is good, and blessed is the one who walks in your law." So let's pray for that. We will hear God's law today. We'll have the grace to walk in his ways. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. It is good. It's true. It's pure. Righteous. We ask today that as we hear your word, we will soften our hearts, that we would not self-justify our ways, but we would be molded by your truth. We thank you for your grace in Jesus, forgiveness of our sins, and grace to walk in your power by the Holy Spirit to live a life. Praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
So if you would, open your Bibles to Exodus chapter 20, verse 16. Exodus chapter 20, verse 16. We're going to continue, as Andy said, going through our series of the Ten Commandments. And church, I would ask you, how are you doing in following the Ten Commandments? I was thinking this week that if God turned the Ten Commandments into a test, I would probably have one of those big red giant S that I saw every so often as a kid at the top of my test saying, "Failed. So far, I am 0 for 8 on living out the Ten Commandments." And if you're just joining in with us in this series, we've only gone through 8 commandments, and today we're on number 9, which if you're thinking, "Well, actually, Grant, I've been doing pretty good on the commandments," well, today will surely condemn you, because today's commandment is one that happens so often, especially in our society, that we don't even think of it as being really that bad. Commandment number 9 deals with lying, bearing false witness. And so I'm going to read from Exodus 20, verse 16, and then we'll dive in. Commandment number 9 says, "You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor." Now, you can see with this commandment that there are two parts to it. The first part, it deals with truth-telling, that you shall not bear false witness. And the second part is out of love for neighbor, a concern for neighbor. Now, it's interesting, last week when Andy preached on the Not So Much Steal, he talked about how the full commandment of thou shalt not steal is found in Ephesians 4, when Paul was writing the letter to the church in Ephesus. And he tells them to no longer steal, but then the positive side is to do honest work so that they can share. Well, right before that verse, Paul talks about truth telling. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25, he says, "Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up." So you see there in Ephesians 4, 28, that we're called to speak the truth, but also towards our neighbor, that there is concern for our neighbor in that, or members of one another, is what he says in Ephesians 4, excuse me. But we're also called to build each other up. And so what I want to do for the rest of our time here today is I want to look at how we break this command, and then what God thinks about it, and then why we do it. So how, what God thinks about it, and why we do it. That is the track that we're going to be running on. So first off, how do we break this command? Well, the first one's the most obvious. It's the bold-faced life. It's where you may be sitting down as a husband, sitting in your chair, getting ready to watch a TV show, ready to relax, and you hear your wife in the distance say, "Honey, can you come help me with this?" And you ignore her. And then she comes out and you say, "I'm sorry, honey, I didn't hear you calling for my help." That is the bold face slide right there. I'm sure we've seen the videos of the little kid who has chocolate all over his face, and the parent walks into the room, and the parent asks him, "Did you eat this chocolate bar?" And the kid's like, nope, not me. And you see the wrapper right next to him. I mean, it's comical because they're so bad at lying. They don't realize that the evidence is all over their face. The perverse side of that is that kids actually know how to lie. I think this is one of the clear signs that points to the sinfulness of mankind. It's that no parent has ever had to teach their kid how to lie to them. No, we teach our kids how to tell the truth, how to do what is right. But kids are born with that ability to lie. Another way we break this command is the silent lie. The silent lie is where we don't use our words, okay, but we allow someone to continue to be deceived even though we know the truth. Let's say, for example, I'm in a cookout with a youth group, Sir John McKenzie, and he says, "Grant, come over here. I want to introduce you to a friend of mine." And we walk over, and George says, "This is Grant, who's our senior pastor with Grace Community Church." And I don't say anything, and I do some sort of awkward greeting because of COVID, want to be safe. But I never correct Jordan's Freudian slip of the tongue there. I then have contributed to that person being deceived. I've contributed in that lie. We also have half-truths. Half-truths is where we're technically saying what is true, but we say it in such a way to where our intent is to deceive, to mislead the person. When I was in my 20s, I would tell girls that I was a painter, or an artist, I would say. Now, in my head, I thought that was halfway true because at the time, I was painting new construction houses, so I dealt with paint. But I would lead them to believe that I was an artist who would actually do, what kind of paintings you call them, but artistic paintings. My intent was to deceive or mislead. Or maybe you tell the story when you leave out the details that would change the whole story. If someone was to ask me if I'm a good golfer, I would say, "Well, yeah, the other day I sunk a 3-foot putt to win a golf outing." You would think, "Wow, he must be pretty good." But see, I left out the details that when I said the other day, I mean 2 years ago, I hit this shot, and that was the only shot, probably, that we used to play on the entire day. The truth is, I'm a terrible golfer. But I would lead you to believe I'm not that bad. And see, we have all these half-truths that manifest themselves often in our gossip and slander of other people. Now, I know that we sometimes get confused on what is technically gossip and slander, but gossip and slander is where we are sharing information about someone, and it may even be true. A lot of the times it's not, but let's say for this instance it is, but our intent is malicious, or our intent is selfish, because we want to be the one who breaks the news to that person. And so we justify it by saying, well, it's not like I'm lying, I'm telling the truth. But if we look back at the ninth commandment, we see that it's not only about telling the truth, but it's also out of concern for our neighbor, out of love for neighbor. And so we're still breaking the ninth commandment, even if we're saying what is true. Another way we break this commandment is through embellishment. We exaggerate how great we are, how good grades we got, how much money we made, how good the business is doing. We embellish our stories to make them more interesting so that people find us more interesting. The classic embellishment with pastors in ministry is the question on how many people attend your church. So if someone is saying, how many people attend CCC, and I respond with 600. I said, really? I said, well, yeah, on Easter we had 500 views on YouTube, so probably a lot of views on our family, so we might have had an extra 100. And that's an embellishment, that's a lie. Because what we're doing is we're taking one time on Easter, when we usually do have the highest attendance, and saying that is our attendance, which is not the case. Another way we break this commandment is through flattery. Flattery is where we give excessive compliments or praise when we don't really mean it. It's telling your boss they did a great job when behind the scenes you think they're a bad boss. You're doing it so that you get in the good graces of that person. So someone might say, great sermon, Pastor. Man, you do such a good job. But then go home and think, that was the worst sermon ever. He's so boring. He just keeps going on and on and on. You know, it's interesting in the Bible where it talks about flattery the most is in regards to false teachers who are wanting to introduce a heresy to the church or line their own pockets with money, or with someone who is wanting to commit sexual sin. So, CCC, be on guard against flattery. Think of it like perfume. It may smell good, but harmful if swallowed. And of course, with all these different ways that we've talked about and how we break the ninth commandment, and there's many more, we also have to think about our online presence. What we pass around through emails and reposts on social media. How many half-truths have we posted on social media? We saw a friend post a one-minute video clip of an entire speech, and so it's taken out of context where its intent is to mislead and deceive, and we automatically then repost it. Many lies are on the internet, especially in an election year. The mountain of lies that exist on social media makes Mount Everest look like a little hill. And you may be thinking, yeah, everyone fibs a time or two. What's the big deal? I try and tell the truth most of the time. I wouldn't call myself a liar. I just lied some of the times. And I find that it's somewhat comical because that's the way I used to think. That we're our inner lawyers, that's that voice where we want to justify what we've done wrong. We spin it in such a way to where we say, I'm not a liar. I just lie sometimes. makes life such a big deal is what God thinks of it. I mean, really, who cares what we think of life? It really doesn't matter. It's of the utmost importance in how God thinks of lying. So in Scripture, there is a term that God uses called abomination. It means repugnant or detestable act. Frequently it's used, or adjectives in the Old Testament that are frequently used in regards to abomination are abhorrent, loathsome, unclean, rejected. And among the sins that Scripture describes as abominations is child sacrifice, bestiality, idolatry, divination, and sorcery. So, not good things. But Proverbs chapter 20, verse 22, says, lying lips are an abomination to the Lord. But those who act faithfully are his delight. Proverbs chapter 6, there are six things that the Lord hates, seven are an abomination to him. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that make haste to run to evil, a false witness who breathes out lies, and one who sows discord among brothers. So think about that. You have seven things that the Lord hates, and two of those is about lying. A lying tongue and a false witness who breathes out lies. At the very end of the Bible, in Revelation chapter 21 and 22, it talks about the glory of heaven, but also about eternal judgment. So in Revelation chapter 21, verse 7, it says, the one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, the sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. And then a few verses later, in that same chapter, it says, but nothing unclean will ever enter into heaven, nor anyone who does what is detestable or false. Only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And then the very next chapter, Revelation 22. Outside are the dogs, the sorcerers, the sexual immoral, and the murderers and idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. So, three times in two chapters, the Bible is making it very clear, that liars, those who love falsehood, those who practice falsehood, are kept out of heaven. That they're thrown into the lake that burns with fire and sulfur. And you think, that seems harsh. Why would God punish like that? Why is there eternal judgment for something that happens so often? And the reason why this is so important to God is because truthfulness is the nature of God himself. God cannot lie. He never has told a lie, and he never will. That's one of the differences between God and man. Romans 3:4, let God be true, though everyone were a liar. Jesus says in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The truthfulness is the very nature of God. On the opposite end, though, the nature of the devil is deceitfulness. He tells bold lies, half-truths, misleading statements. Jesus says this about Satan in John chapter 8. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. You can see that when we lie, we're acting like Satan. This is one of the reasons why it's a big deal to God, and whatever is false is not allowed in the heaven, because God is truth. Another reason I'm not going to go into is God's holiness. But what I want to focus on here today is that because God is truth, it's the very nature of who God is. And if you think that, well, who could stand before God? Who in their right mind has never told a lie and will be able to make it into heaven? But that is the right question to ask. Because when Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, he went on to say, no one comes to the Father except through me. See, that earlier passage I read in Revelation 21, it says, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life make it into heaven. The Lamb's book of life is Jesus Christ. He was the sacrificial lamb on the cross. That's why he went to the cross, is to pay for all of our sins, to pay for all the times that we've been deceitful. He ended up dying on the cross for our sins, bearing the punishment for our sins, and then rising from the grave 3 days later and ascending back up into heaven where he is reigning and ruling. And he calls us to repent of our sins and trust in what he has done in order for us to be able to stand before God on that last day. There is a glorious promise in, excuse me, in John chapter 6. He says that he will not turn any away who come to him, but that if you repent and trust in him as your Lord and Savior, you will be saved. And that is the good news of the gospel. If you're listening here today and you realize that you've lied, that you stand under God's judgment, I plead with you to turn to Jesus Christ. For no one comes to the Father except through him. And if you're a born-again Christian, and you've already done that, I want us to think about the why when we lie. To get down to the root of when we lie. Because as many of you know, even when we come to Christ and we've repented of our sins, there's still this sinful flesh inside of us that wages war against us being truthful at all times. And when we can get down to the root of why we sin, we're able then to put it to death as the Bible calls us to. And so I just want to share two broad reasons. I know there's many reasons why we lie, but I want to share with us two broad reasons why too many of us in the Bible lie, and then how we can combat that with the truth of Scripture. So the first reason why we lie is to cover up and hide. If we go back in the beginning of the Bible, in the Garden of Eden, with Adam and Eve, and then Satan deceives them, and they eat the forbidden fruit, what do? After they eat the fruit that God told them not to, they run to cover up and hide. They realize they were naked, so they try and cover themselves. To see, once they sin, the relationship with God and with one another was different. It was changed. They were no longer in the security and satisfaction of those relationships. And when they were covering up, that's a picture of what we do when we lie. In fact, when a crime is committed, or not even a crime, but something bad, and then the people try and prevent the truth from coming out, what do we call that? A cover-up. We're trying to hide what happened. Probably the most famous cover-up story in the Bible deals with King David. When he committed adultery with Bathsheba, and he found out she was pregnant, he tried to cover it up by murdering Bathsheba's husband. Why does the little kid throw away the candy wrapper and try to clean his face off before the parents see what he did? He's trying to cover up the evidence. Why is the teenager spraying himself with cologne or perfume and popping a mint before they come inside? They're trying to cover up the evidence. Why is the employee lying to his boss when the project's not done? He's trying to cover up the reason why he did not get that done. And In John chapter 3, verse 19, it says that light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works should be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. See, when we cover up, we're going back to the darkness. We're staying in the darkness because we're afraid to be exposed. And the gospel of Jesus Christ calls us to walk in the light. That God has seen all the deeds we have done, that the darkness is as light to Him, and that He knows our past darkness and our future darkness, and yet He still accepts us. There's no reason to cover up and hide what we've done. We're missing out on communion with God when we go back to the darkness that God has rescued us from. Psalm 32 says, "For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, the Lord's hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up in the heat of the summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. And I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And you forgave the iniquity of my sin." It's when we expose our works, it's when we come back out into the light that we experience the joy of a clean conscience and the joy of communing with God. So many of us, I'm afraid, hurt that relationship we have with God. We miss out on the fullness of life. And we're worried about what someone might find out about us. We're constantly trying to cover our tracks. And today is a day that we can step out into the light again. I remember the feeling I had when I realized the freedom in Christ. That I no longer had to be concerned with what people might find out about me because I was walking in the light. The burden was lifted. Ephesians 5:8 says, "For one time you were in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true." We do not need to run back to darkness to cover up our deeds. We're called to walk in the light. Another reason why a lot of us lie is to get something that we want. In Genesis chapter 25, Isaac's wife, Rebekah, gave birth to twins, Esau and Jacob. And before they were born, God promised that the older would serve the younger. Now, when Rebekah gave birth, Esau came out first, and then Jacob. Now, to us, it's not a big deal, but in the ancient Near East back then, the firstborn was a big deal. He got much more of the inheritance. And so later in life, when Isaac, their dad, was very old and his eyesight was very bad, he was getting ready to give out the blessings to the children. And Jacob deceives his father, tricks his father, and goes in to get the firstborn blessing, which created massive division within the family then. Now, why did Jacob do that? It's because he wanted to secure that blessing, so he lied about it. He didn't believe and trust in God and what God had said. See, why would I tell people when I was in my 20s that I was an artist rather than just a painter? Because I wanted to gain their acceptance. Why do we tell people stories that make us look like the heroes and others look like they're the bad people? It's because we want ourselves to look good in front of others. Why do we rely on our resumes to secure that blessing of that job? Why do we cheat on our taxes in order to get more money in our bank account? Why do we engage in flattery? Because we want to get the favor of that person. See, when we lie on our resume and get that job, we're not trusting in God's sovereignty, that He's able to work all things for our good, that He has good plans for us. We think we have to lie in order to get it. And maybe you're in sales and you're involved where you continually have to deceive people. Why do we do that? Because we want that extra money. We want to make a sale. And we're not trusting in the fact of God's provision for us. See, we see God's commitment to care for our needs at the cross. Romans 8:32, He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also with Him graciously give us all things? Why do we try to impress people by embellishing what we've done and making others look bad? Because we don't realize we have the acceptance of the King. We're not content in that. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus tells us that when people revile you or utter false things against you, to rejoice and be glad, for great is your reward in heaven. See, when we have an eternal perspective of life, we are free from needing the praise of man. See, when you've been accepted and even treasured by the President of the United States, you no longer are worried about if the mayor of Gridley accepts you. We have the King. And this is what we miss out on. We don't need to lie to secure the blessing, for if we are in Christ, we have every blessing. Ephesians chapter 1. So church, let's be a people that put off falsehood, deceitfulness, half-truths, embellishments, flattery. Let's be a people that stand upon the Word of God, that stand in truthfulness. See, as we've gone through these 10 commandments, I know that often we are confused on, do we have to obey the 10 commandments? Aren't we under grace and not under law? But when we walk in the law of God, in these 10 commandments, empowered by the Holy Spirit, what we do is reflect the glory of God to this world. That people are able to look at the church and say, that is what God is like. And especially when it comes to truthfulness, for God's nature is truth. So let's walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, speaking the truth to one another in love, and showing that this world, which is bent on deceitfulness and lying, that we are a people who are truthful. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the grace and mercy that we find in Jesus Christ. And Lord, You know every word from our lips. And Father, I pray that You would empower us to speak truth, even when it's at great cost to ourselves. That we would rightly reflect Your glory, Lord, to this world. And that we would speak truth and live truth. Help us see, Lord, when we do lie, the grace that is found in You. And help us also see why we are lying, Lord. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. And for those of you online, we're going to continue to meet outdoors until the weather gets cold, and then we'll move indoors. But I'm glad you've joined us online, and we'll see you soon.